preach. He's been my mother and my father.
Romans, verse 35, I think. Am I right, choir? Romans 8, 35. Am I right, choir? I mean, you don't have to go there, right? Choir, did I call the scripture wrong or y'all forgot? Choir, y'all supposed to close y'all back. What you mean? Y'all ain't heard that? Why y'all shaking your head on me? And like, go ahead.
Or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword. As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter.
Y'all remember kicking in your anybody?
Read it good, Jamina. Read it good.
You act like I done went insane or something. I'm telling y'all something y'all ain't never heard. Go ahead. Hey.
Yeah, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded.
Go ahead. Do y'all remember now? Do y'all remember now? Do y'all remember now?
Yeah.
Anybody remember now? Okay, go ahead. Well, what? No, neither what?
That neither death.
Y'all remember that now? Go ahead. Tell me, I done went in the Bible and read, had a verse read that didn't nobody but Jamina know what? You mean ain't Can't nobody relate. That's the first time you gonna stand me. Eight 35, King James. Get it, and let's stand up and read it together. 8:30, get you a Bible. 8, help for I'm giving. You ain't got that, say it, amen. 8:35. Lord have mercy. Come over here, Jermaine. Come on over here, Mr. Jermaine. Lead in the reading, amen. 8:30, read out of King James, amen. That's King James, right. Come on up here, come on. All right, then, we're going to read it together. Start. Where are you starting at, what, 35? All right, okay. Everybody got it? Raise your hand if you got it. Romans. Yep, that little girl, that faith helping to find it. Amen, give it that. In Romans, amen. 8:35 in the New Testament, amen. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. What? Romans? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. That's hard to do. Turn to the New Testament. See Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. All right, dear. Okay, we're going to read it together. Come on.
Verse 35.
Read it together. Come on.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
All right, then. I'm going to try to do this in 15. I'm just going to do just a short portion of what the Lord gave me. And I'll have to do this again, but there's a verse in the 20th chapter of Revelation, about verse 13. Go there, I kind of got to tie this in. And once it gets so that you can see that once you learn to read, know where certain scriptures are, that you should be able to read something in the Bible without hearing a sermon. We should be able to read certain scriptures and the word. I mean, the Bible is not that deep. It's written, Jesus spoke in the simplest form of the Greek language, the common Greek. He did not speak in sophisticated. He spoke in Aramaic, the common language of the people, and few people that knew. And the writers wrote in common Greek language. Paul, the great apostle, who was Saul, persecuting the church, and they changed his name to Paul because he was so short. It wasn't because he was cute. He was a bad somebody in little 4'8" self, humpback. He was badder than Sheriff Heggie, badder than Judge, than Sheriff Buford in Atlanta, walking tall. He was highly educated, and all of his writing wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. A scholar, an aristocrat, could speak and converse and write fluently in seven different languages. He knew the Greek, and he knew the classical Greek. But he said, in all of my knowledge, I count it all as dung, translated, manure. I count all of my knowledge
as feces. He spoke in what you would call cursing tongues. He used gutter language sometimes. Mm-hmm. And he only was permitted to write to show, and he didn't write to show off his learning, but the Hebrew letter, which many scholars don't think that Paul wrote it because it's such high classical literature, such Shakespearean type, such, looks like a Bible college professor with 2 or 3 degrees of doctorates wrote it. But they don't realize that Paul loved the Jews, his people, so much. When the Lord called him to be an apostle, I ain't time to go down there and hear all these little false apostles running around here. But when the Lord called him to be an apostle, Paul was a Jew of the Jews. He was on the Sanhedrin court. And if anybody that had a racial pride, it was Paul. But the Lord called him with all his racial pride. He said, you a Jew of the Jews, but I'm sending you to the Gentiles. And before he died, the Hebrew letter was written in high classical Greek, so much so that many scholars think that, but he said something about Timothy in the Hebrew letter and other things. See, the schools that I was taught in was the old school, and we didn't have no questions about so-called contradictions. Every so-called contradiction, we were able to show by the scripture there wasn't no contradiction. We just need to understand what it was saying. And he said, I'm determined to know nothing among you but Christ Jesus. I count all my knowledge. So what I'm saying is that if you read the Bible, if you're having trouble understanding anything in it, especially with getting a Living Bible translation or NIV translation, then you need to check out whether or not you know. How many know that when you really don't know a person, it's something about a teacher or professor or boss, look like it's hard, you look like you have a hard time in a new teacher, a new class, or a new job. You know what makes it so hard? Because you can't understand what the boss wants you to do, what it means. But once you get to sit down and once you learn, if you could ever learn, if you could ever sit down and talk and find out what the boss really is about, you would have a better understanding. You'd be able to do your job better with joy, because now I understand why he wants us to be here on time and to do this just like this here. And all I'm saying, I say this short, the secret is you need to learn the man who told the man. You need to learn. You need to find out who God is. You need to find who Jesus is. You need to find that the author called man, yes, man wrote the Bible, but man did not sit down and have his own inspiration write. The Bible says men of old, starting in the Old Testament, wrote as moved by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost that gets on some of y'all and make you shout and make you run around, the Holy Ghost got on them and took over their minds and took over their fingers, and they found themselves writing something. And in the day when they didn't have typewriters, God used their minds and their fingers as automatic typewriters, and they began to write and had to read what they wrote. They were the Holy Ghost, starting with the prophets, would get on them, and the apostles wrote as moved by the Holy Ghost, got hold of their pen. And they were looking and said, God so loved the world that he gave his own begotten son. He told one to write this here parable, another to write this miracle. And said, I know you don't understand that, but what you're looking at a demonstration. I don't understand how these preachers can be so caught up. I can't understand and can look at the clock and say, I'm going to do it in 29 minutes and half is off, and go and tell somebody to hit the key. Of Because when I get in the spirit, when I see the clock, I'm looking right at it. I don't go blind. The clock see me, but I don't see the clock. When I can look at the clock and my mind recognize that it's 2 something or whatever it is, or 2:30, then I know it's time. That's Holy Ghost have released my mind. I don't know whether or not y'all shouting holy or jumping up and down. I'm looking right at you. I'm blind, but I'm in the spirit. You ought to know that. You ought to be able to look at me and to tell, look at here. Yeah, I look. I know. Look. You ought to be able to look and say, he's out of here.
Amen.
He is drugged up.
Yeah.
And it wasn't on heroin or horse. It's Holy Ghost. I mean, are y'all having problems realize what it means to get caught up? See, y'all trying to beat the devil running. And the devil, how many know the devil's spirit is very powerful in the world? And getting stronger and stronger. I ain't got time to go there. Got to say this here little thing. You know, I use up 6-7 minutes of my time. But, okay, give me Revelation 20 and 13.
And the sea gave up the dead.
Okay, go ahead.
Which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their work.
Go ahead.
And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
Go ahead. And?
And whosoever was not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
Go ahead.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem.
Books are open. I need to help you where it said the word said, and the books were open. In there, right in, it's right in there, y'all.
Yes, sir. Right here.
Yeah, okay, the books are open. I need that.
And
yeah,
12th verse.
Okay.
I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works.
And
the sea gave up the dead.
All right, okay.
Which were in it.
Okay, that's far. I want you to understand that the Bible talks about what they call theologically the great white throne judgment. It goes on later on to say, you need to go and read this whole thing, that there's going to be a time when all the dead people in the world and those that are alive and have been caught up in the rapture, and the 1,000 years is ended, and the 7.5 years, and then 1,000 years. It's going to be a time when everybody, and goes on down to say that in order for this to happen, everybody that's been in the sea or on the mountains, been burnt or buried in the sea, going to come to life. And they all going to stand before the judgment bar of God. And the microfilm, the FBI police record, the video, holy video recording that has recorded everything you have done or thought is going to be your diary. Is going to be in the books. There's going to be a set of books that has your record, whether it be good or bad. But what is important is not the books, because that can be.
Yes, sir.
We'll be in bad trouble if they look at every page and everything you thought and has done. and you're going to be judged out of that. Because you will not, I don't care how good you are, there's some good people that are not saved. Amen. There are going to be some good people in hell. Some people, gangsters as they are, I guess they can find, I hope they can find, they say they can find some good in Al Capone. Drug dealers die, get shot down. And they have big funerals. More people come to their funeral than the bishop's funerals. They put them in, bury them, put them in their major, in their favorite Cadillac and lower them in the ground in their favorite Cadillac. Come on here now. Change their suits 6 or 7 times. Because it takes 2 or 3 days for people to come and look at them. And they talk about how they helped with all the drug money, how many people's they sent to college anyhow. Amen. And you could walk up to them and ask them for a favor, and they'd give you $100 bill. Yeah. But they still might be in hell.
Amen.
Because this set of books, I don't care how many good deeds are in it, the Bible, and I don't know where in the world you got this mess from. I just feel like that when the end is, if I can, they can look in the books, and I have done more good than I have bad. If my good outweighs my bad, well, in the first place, if you're taking that principle, I don't care just because you fed somebody, that don't mean you're good. I don't care if you take the drug money and give it to your mama and buy her a house. All the damage, you cannot account for all the people's life you damage.
Amen.
All the prostitutes, all somebody's sons and daughters.
Amen.
All the people that got shot or they got their minds messed or gone to jail because you got, I gave $1,000. I had to tell somebody this morning, I said, why are you up here? Because
yeah.
I want to get my money, I want to give some money. I said, you... In the Good News translation, let me read you something, because some of y'all think, Good News, give me the Good News translation, by give me Acts 8:22. Good News translation. I want you to read what the Bible, what Apostle Peter said to a man about his money. Y'all can look it up in the other, look it up in the King James. Someone read it in the King James. Someone read in the King James, Acts 8:22.
Repent.
Slowly. Yeah. Okay, now I want you to read. Someone read in Acts 8:22, King James.
King James.
Repent, therefore, of this thy wickedness, and pray, God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee.
All right, now, this is a man who saw the apostle. You saw what going on. They saw the apostles so much loaded and anointed with God's Holy Ghost power that they, as they touched people, people fell out, people speaking in tongues, people were dancing, people were being healed. And he had been a magician and had the power of witchcraft working with him and could do marvelous things. And he got saved. And when he saw them doing all those things, he came up to Peter and said, how much money can I give you? You know, I got money. I just got saved, but my business been lucrative. I'm a psychic worker. I got a psychic worker working for me. Say, how much money do you need so I can get in this craft and this guild? So when I touch people, things happen to them. What did Peter say in the Living Bible translation?
Repent then of this evil plan of yours. And pray to the Lord that he will forgive you for thinking such a thing as this. For I see that you are full of bitter envy and are a prisoner of sin.
Okay, don't say. What version that says you and your money go to hell?
The 20th verse.
20th verse, go ahead.
But Peter answered him, may you and your money
do what?
Go to hell.
Mm-hmm. All right, okay then. Apostle Peter said in the straight Greek translation, see, the King James is written in poetry. He spoke in Elizabethan English. But these different translations go back to just as it was said in the Greek. See, read it again, verse 8 and 20.
But Peter answered him.
Apostle Peter said,
may you and your money go to hell.
And then he talked, then go and read about repentance.
Repent then of this evil plan of yours and pray to the Lord that he will forgive you for thinking such a thing as this. For I see that you are full of bitter envy and are a prisoner of sin.
All right, now, I've got to weave this together in 5 minutes. The closing book of the Bible tells us that the day is going to come where you're going to be judged. And it doesn't matter how much good or bad you have in the books. You will not have enough good to overbalance the bad. You're not going to be saved by the good deed, but when you give your life to the Lord, and let him begin when you repent. If you give your life to the Lord, it means you repent. That means you turn your back on sin. That don't mean that you automatically stop sinning and never sin anymore.
Amen.
But when you turn your back on sin and look toward the Lord, that every time your humanity rises up, and every time you hear the gospel preached, you're not going to get mad and leave the church and talk about, I don't want to hear that mess. It's too hard.
Amen.
If you have really repented, you're going to work on yourself. And thank, praise God anyhow, because I'm so grateful that he let me live.
Yeah.
He looked beyond my faults. He did better. He looked right at my fault. He let me know through the preacher that look here. I know what you're doing, but God.
Yes. Man, that's it.
I keep on telling you, don't get mad at me. I'm just a mailman.
Amen.
If you get mad, you better pray and get glad, because I'm still, when I warn you, I'm taking flack. I love the Lord and love you enough to let you know. Look here, it's either heaven or hell.
Amen.
Now, what's important, I'm trying to say it because I'm looking at people, I had to send them over. I've heard from two leaders. Somebody spoke to the choir, the minister of music, last Sunday night. I had to remind the choir to go in and remind them that don't leave out here talking about, well, it wasn't about 14, 15, maybe 18 people. I had to remind them that, look, when you hear people being upset, when you hear people, let me help you out, being, don't leave here talking about, he really was mad at us. I said, let me help you out. So if you're married or have a relationship, a girl, a boyfriend, or employed, when they get mad at you, what is the first emotional reaction you should realize other than leaving out, talking about they sure was mad as hell? Or the real, and somebody finally spoke, but most of them were wrestling with it and retorted. When somebody is angry at you, it's because whether it's justified or not, they've been hurt. But all you can think of, they sure are hell fire mad. I don't know why they went off like it. That's the expression. They've been hurt. When you hear people quitting, they've been hurt. It should have been a get. No, I just had to look back. He should not have been allowed to get out that door after he had said how hurt he was.
That's right.
Ain't nobody know? Oh, y'all don't even know what I'm talking about. I know what it is to stand up here.
Amen.
I know the feeling to be so straight. This is what I want to let you know.
Amen.
That I don't care how strong you are, you cannot help but your body reacting to the stress factor.
Amen.
I don't care how strong and how much faith I have, and that don't keep me from feel like quitting.
Amen.
I don't care how righteous I am and what my wife do. That don't exempt me from never feeling like
Amen.
Doing something else. Come
That's
on.
That's right, Bishop.
That's Shut
it.
Up.
That's right.
You ought to know, I don't care how holy you are,
no,
how old you are, and how much you get.
That's right.
No, you're not going to be exempt from the feeling. The devil ain't going to be the same. But I can't make
you. That's
You cannot escape.
Amen.
You stay poor long enough, you're going to have to be wrestled with. I feel like stealing.
That's right.
I still like wheeling and dealing. I feel like going back to what I used to do. You can't escape the feeling, because the devil can't get nowhere unless he get the feeling going. He got to have something to work with. And as long as you in this flesh, you cannot help but have feelings. We ought to realize that when major people, people that you know the pastor depends on, if the devil can look around, what it look like if everybody, I look around and all my preachers,
that's right.
I can't take it no more. Amen. And they know better than that, but that's y'all right. Act like, don't tell me because you're a deacon or a deaconess or because you're here or that. I don't understand this. I don't care. I cannot exempt you from that.
Amen.
I don't understand why you, one little person here talking about your feelings hurt.
Yes.
How do you take that? I look at 50 people that move right. Right. And
that's
you act like right. That. I don't feel bad.
That's right.
Yes. Go,
yes.
Go crazy.
That's
right.
Bishop.
You think it don't hurt me?
Yeah. Yes, it does.
And when I hurt, you don't think it does something to the stress?
Yes.
You don't think some bad hormone be released?
Yes.
You don't think I can't react to the stress? Man, I'm just as human as you are.
Yes. Yes.
That's right. That's right.
You look like that the devil gonna sneak up one by one.
Yes.
So last Sunday night, somebody was, well, that's he just right. Said that because that's his son.
Uh-huh.
Well, what about that one?
That's right. That's right.
That's right.
Amen. Amen.
I don't realize yet
yes.
That I didn't have no problems.
Amen.
Some of you still can't realize. Look right at it and don't understand why I got Allen's.
Yes.
And one or two Patterson.
Yes.
I didn't have no problem. They were not no steps to me.
Yes. Yes.
Ask any of them.
Amen. Amen.
You can't relate to that.
Amen.
And you can't relate to the fact you don't understand. You can't understand that I love you like that.
Yes. Yes.
Love.
Yes.
I don't understand. I gotta quit, huh? I don't understand these parents that love the nigga boy.
Yes. That's it. That's it. Reach it, Bishop. That's it.
And the girl get out of my face.
Yeah. Say, man.
I don't understand how you got a favorite child.
Yeah. Preach it. Preach it.
You don't understand that. Because y'all react that way. You don't understand.
Amen.
And a God can't love me. I told you yesterday. You don't understand. I don't need that. Don't need that. And I say to any woman in here, I love you and I can hug you. If you need a hug, I mean a real tight hug, you may ask my permission.
Amen.
Or not ask her, but she ain't gonna get upset. And I can hug you, and I don't have to explain that I'm hugging you and I love you like a dog.
Amen.
And I don't have no problem hugging you.
Amen.
You're cute or pretty or sweet smell. I don't have no problem getting excited.
That's right.
In the flesh, I don't have to.
Amen.
Love,
yes.
So God pay love.
Yes.
And the fact that God tell me, if I don't go by hurt feelings, you go by a few hurt feelings, or one hurt feeling, and I get hurt every Sunday when
every
I know.
That's right.
God sometimes said to Paul, I blessed you, I gave you the money.
Yes.
Like I do not know that.
That's it. Yes. That's it. Yes. That's
don't
it.
Tell me
man.
This is the money.
Yes.
Here I am.
That's right.
That's
right.
I'm not dumb.
Yes.
I have an organization of
yes.
How you think this church got so far?
Yes.
I taught them. When you see people die, I taught them first.
Yes.
You teach me?
No.
from A to Z.
Yes.
How to do.
Yes.
Mama taught me first call me, saying I start doing works out of the day. I taught him. He listened to me.
Amen.
And after a while, yes, he's a pastor teacher.
Yes.
But he wouldn't have got there unless I gave him a foundation.
Amen.
I trained the deacon.
Yes.
You didn't get it back because you were ready to be a deacon?
No.
I trained the preacher.
Yes.
Agape love.
Yes.
When God tells me to love you, I don't have no problems. So I mean, I got to, I mean, one or two times. I like going to that book. Lord came in agreement with his will. I remember in agreement with his will. When somebody died, and I went to the funeral. Somebody that was supposed to be in the funeral that had eaten and sat at the table with David, and other children.
Study, acting, hurrying over, growling, tearing off the street.
they went out there and couldn't, so I went out there. And she looked up at me and growled at me. All I saw was that demon in her. And I reached to grab that demon. I was going to reach inside and grab that demon and throw it out. And the Holy Ghost, he saw the Holy Ghost caught me. The Holy Ghost kept me. The Holy Ghost caught me. The Holy Ghost caught me. If the Holy Ghost hadn't caught me, you would have been down in there, because I forgot. All I heard was that demon.
Yeah.
And I was reading for that demon. He been extending the invitation again. I don't care what you do, what preacher let you get by. I done passed that test a long time ago. I've been warned in the book that the day would come where they would not endure sound doctrine.
Yes.
I'm going to preach against homosexuality,
yes,
and lesbianism,
yes,
and sacking.
Yes. Yes.
And remarrying for no reason, and re-divorcing, and some don't even get divorced, and living together openly, and then walk up in God's house, you ought to be all this, all of that, and can be pregnant. Openly seeing it, he's got the nerve. And I just said something to a person, ain't nobody big enough.
Amen.
I don't care if I had to stand on a bench and step on a step ladder. I don't care if you need to stand on me. Something in me, and you ain't going to hit me.
Right. Amen.
I have a contract.
Yes.
You better hit Shaq on me or Tyson. You ain't going to hit me. The same hoes going to grab me or grab you. I have earned a contract.
Yes.
I'm God's man.
Yes.
I ain't scared. I don't care. You got a 45. If it fired, it's going to go back, but it ain't going to hit me.
Sitting on the choir stand in their seat that they said 2 weeks before that time. I'm going to leave here, and I'm going to leave right in that seat in one
morning.
Our Bishop Allen was preaching.
Yes.
Someone said, come. Something wrong. I think you told me. Something wrong with Barbara. And she was sitting up there. Her eye looked so blue.
Yes.
I knew she was gone sitting up straight. See, some of y'all don't know this, or half of y'all don't know this. She didn't look straight. I knew she was gone. But I knew
perhaps the Lord might use me to call a spirit back. When I touched her, she said, and I knew that when I touched her, the Lord cut the silver cord. Because I knew that if the Lord wanted to, he could use my touch and call her back. And that's when I told him to get her and take her out. She was gone. When you see the Lord taking operation, a Jewish surgeon did a heart operation on her, a large heart. She healed many of her. The Lord used to heal many of her. She's a big hand now. He's continuing with her ministry. But when she had to go to the hospital with a large heart, it got so bad that when she come in from the meeting, that they could see her heart getting addressed, I believe, getting her chest and addressed being pumped. Call over Robbins. And over Robbins prayed for it. He came out and said, it's dark and long. He was saved and telling her staff for 3 or 4 minutes. I'm going to go home. The key to spiritual growth can be so I'm going to tell you right now, the Lord is still trying to speak to you. Some of you sit up here and be ready to go. When you're trying to get ready and act like you got the life and said, I ain't going to die. I can do what I want to until. And your name is not in the book of life. Just stand.
I mean, I knew there was an unusual anointing on this song. You can tell a true person who loves the Lord because something happens when you say the name Jesus. Let me see everyone who loves the name of Jesus just to stand up on your feet and cry it as loud as you can. Come on, call it. Saved but by the name of Jesus. And not only that, listen, there's healing. If you're sick, just touch your body right now and begin to call on the name of Jesus.
Bless that man. Oh,
we sing a great chorus of glory to his name. In the name, I love to call the name Jesus. Can you sing it with us, Jesus? Say it again, Jesus. Jesus, we love you. We love you. We love you. We love you. Love that name.